I have to apologise for the laptop not cooperating. I'm doing the old switch it off and switch it on again to see if that helps. Okay, so my name, if you don't already know me, is Steve Rivett. And I'm from Risco SO Group. And we're, in a way, we're the custodians of the shared source Risco S project. On behalf of Castle Technology, who own the license for Risco S, and they own Risco S itself. So our job, as we see it, is to manage the shared source project. Oh, hello, we have some display. Our job is to fiddle around with laptops all day, trying to make them work. So yes, we try and guide the development of Risco S. We try and help the community in as many ways as we can. And we watch our laptops stop working again. Just when you thought you had a presentation. I'll gesture it. Computers. When we do this in Risco S, it will of course work perfectly. Multi-head support. So let's try one last thing. I know we should hassle Jeffrey Lee to finish the multi-head support. It's not far off, I don't think. We've got Adrian Leeds back on the scene doing his Geminis stuff with multi-head. No, it's not cooperating. Okay, so what I wanted to talk about today was something that I've done at the previous couple of shows. I've talked about it at the Southwest show and at Wakefield. But it wouldn't be fair if I didn't come along and give the same sort of presentation here. I'd like to talk about what Risco S Open do behind the scenes, as well as talking a bit about what we've been doing recently and what's new at this show. I'd like to talk about some of the reasons why we do things the way we do them. I'd be happy to hear about your ideas for how we can do things better or what we could do that we're not already doing. And then I'll talk a little bit about what we're going to be doing in the future and the direction we think Risco S is going in. So first of all, who are Risco S Open? So we're a group of volunteers. There's a few members who've been there from the outset. There are six shareholders for the company, Risco S Limited, Risco S Open Limited. There's myself and Ben Averson, who's on the stand. There's a guy called Andrew Hodgkinson, who he's emigrated to New Zealand now. He's one of our developers, but he also maintains our website and all of the back-end stuff behind the website. And there's a few other shareholders, three other people who were there when we set up the company, so they have an equal stake in it, but they don't really take any part in Risco S anymore. They're more backseat. So day to day, it's primarily just Ben and myself. We have a few honorary members who do an awful lot of work behind the scenes to keep things ticking along. One of them is Jeffrey Lee, who I'm sure a lot of you will recognise. Jeffrey does a lot of the development work, core development work, at the heart of Risco S, adding new and interesting features and making Risco S work on platforms like Raspberry Pi and the BeagleBoard. We also have an honorary member called Rob Sproson, who's also known as Spro on the forums. And Rob Sproson handles all of our merchandising and dealing with orders that come in through the website and getting things dispatched out to people and handling any problems people have there. As well as lots of work recently to do with the RISC PC support, getting Risco S5 working properly on the RISC PC. We have a guy called Theo Marquettis, who's been doing lots of things with package managers and auto builders and things like that, which are one of the things that Risco S is sadly lacking in is a way of having automatic updates for all of the bits of software that you've got installed on your system. And we're gradually introducing a thing called Pac-Man, which is it's getting there, but it's still a long way from being finished. So Theo does a lot of work behind the scenes doing that. And there's another honorary member I'd like to introduce today, and he's called James Byrne. And James has been doing a load of work for us in the past year on the documentation side. Most of it you won't have seen, but one of the things we've released today is a new version of the development tools. And on the DDE, as it's called, there's a set of manuals for various important tools like the C compiler and the assembler, as well as the DDE as a whole. And those manuals are proper books authored by Acorn using a pronoun called FrameMaker. But the original versions of those books, were using a prehistoric version of FrameMaker. And a few years ago, they were updated to a fairly current version as of that time. And now there's a whole pile of work that we needed to do to bring it up to the latest version and address all of the content, which was horrifically out of date. So one of the examples is the style guide, which most people use as their reference for how to design the user interface on their applications. The last update to that was 1994. And so finally, 20 years later, we've got an updated version. There's a lot more work we want to do there. One of the notable things is there's a set of volumes called the Programmer's Reference Manuals. And we've got a whole load of work we want to do to those. But by our estimation, there's about a year and a half worth of work to do there. And unfortunately, no one has that much time available. But it's all little incremental steps. And James Byrne has been instrumental in doing all of that work on our latest DDE. And so now James has been adopted into our organisation. Hopefully we can start pointing him at other bits of manual updates that he can do. So it's useful to get that started. Yeah. That's a good presentation. Oh, fantastic. So that's who we are. There's also, it's not really as simple as a small organisation like us. What we really are, we are the community. So we're just the figureheads, I suppose. We're the central meeting point of the community. But really, most of what's going on is not done by RiskOS Open. It's done by other people. And we try and gather it all together and organise it in a way that makes sense. So without the community taking part and doing what they do, RiskOS would just stall, pretty much, because just the people at RiskOS Open, we don't have enough time to do all the things that need doing. So what do we do? Well, I've told you a lot about that, but for the most part, we are dealing with email inquiries that come in, and there's all kinds of inquiries. There's people who just need help with things, there's people asking about products, there's people who've got faulty products, and there's people wanting to do new things with RiskOS. So there's been some commercial inquiries, so people wanting to do top secret projects with RiskOS and needing help. And we manage a bugs database, so we manage the list of all the known problems with RiskOS, and hopefully we point developers at bugs and get bugs squashed. We also have our thing called bounty scheme. So we have various nominated, highlighted pieces of development that we think are of value to RiskOS, and we try and collect money into a pot for each of those. And when the money gets to a certain level, a developer might think, yeah, that looks interesting. I'll claim that pot of money and do that piece of work. And if they do it to the right standard, then we'll just give them the money. So that's the bounty scheme has been very useful for getting some projects off the ground that otherwise probably wouldn't have happened. But I still think if there was more money in that scheme, it might encourage more developers and we might see even more work happening. But it's always a difficult thing to ask for money for something that may never happen. As well as that, we've got actual development work. So we do some development work. Not a great deal, unfortunately, because time doesn't permit. But one of the things Ben does through RiskOS Open is contract work for Raspberry Pi. So this kind of our voluntary side which is the work that we do in the community, and there's the consultancy side, which is completely divorced from it, that does some commercial development projects. And one of them that Ben has been doing for Raspberry Pi has been optimizing Raspbian. So it's not even RISC-OSS related, but it's just because of Ben's specialist knowledge, he's been able to do a lot of low-level ARM code on Raspbian to accelerate it on the Raspberry Pi. And some of that stuff is just, it's all lodged in Ben's brain now. And he's, at some point, hopefully, he'll be able to bring some of what he's learned over to the RISC-OS side and improve low-level bits of RISC-OS, improve performance, hardware-specific optimizations. So there are a lot of different aspects of what RISC-OS Open is doing, and we're constantly looking at new things we could be doing and ways we could be improving things. But the important thing to remember, for the most part, aside from that consultancy aspect, for the most part, we're just a not-for-profit. We're not paying ourselves for our time. We rely entirely on donations and people buying our merchandise, like the sort of things we've got on the stand today. And we appreciate most of that merchandise is probably, you know, a mug for £6, you could say that's an expensive mug, but really, you're not buying a mug, you're just showing some support for RISC-OS Open. And we're not going to take that profit and pay ourselves. We're going to take that money and put it into the pots that will help us come to shows, answer people's questions, and do all that kind of thing. So it's all brilliant, it's all very helpful. When we find a little surplus of money in the bank account, we can put it into the bounty scheme and we can help. We've done this recently. We can help move all these little bounties along by putting a bit more money in the pot. So some of the things that are new at this show, I've said about the development tools. We've updated a lot of documentation. We've also fixed a lot of bugs. Got a new version of the compiler that fixes some quite fundamental bugs. It can target the Raspberry Pi specifically, so you can optimize your code for that. We've got the assembler has some ARM v7 and v8 support, which is new. You can build transient utilities using the linker from straight from C source files. This is new. And we've got a load of other things behind the scenes. But if you're a user, that's not particularly interesting, but it's one of the things we've released at this show. Another thing that we're working on at the moment, which didn't make it into the show, is the next major release of RISC-OS, which is RISC-OS 5.22. And that is going to be hopefully available on the Panda board as well as on the Raspberry Pi and RISC PC and the Ionix. So hopefully we're going to support more platforms than we have previously. We've never done a proper Panda board download from our website, for example, that's got all of the stuff packaged together. That hopefully will be over the next month or two, we'll get that one out. There's a lot of work to come from the development tools, and these are fundamental bits of development. There's some work to do with USB audio that hopefully we'll be able to integrate into RISC-OS. And there's some work to do with EDID support. Now, EDID is what I perfectly demonstrated not working on other operating systems. So when you plug a monitor into your computer, it can usually read information from the monitor that says what the monitor can do. And EDID support in RISC-OS is hopefully going to do correctly what lots of other operating systems do very badly, which is to automatically configure your monitors when you plug them in and just make them work. It does tie in a bit to some other work that's ongoing in Jeffrey Lee's back burner, but it's not ready yet, and that's the multi-head support, and that's where you've got multiple monitors on one system so your desktop can span across them. And hopefully with EDID support and multi-head support done correctly, you'll be able to just plug a projector into your RISC piece, into your Raspberry Pi or whatever, and it will just appear as an extended bit of desktop over to the side. So there's loads of work there. One of the things that we also introduced this year was recurring donations to help support RISC-OS Open. And we do as I said, we sell merchandise and we take donations, but one of the things people kept asking us for was just to be able to set up a recurring donation so they can give, say, £5 a month. And it's amazing how those things add up, because over the history of RiskOS Open, we've seen the exposure of RiskOS in the public eye increase exponentially almost. So from being almost dead when we set up the company in 2006, I think RiskOS was on a gradual decline and was eventually going to peter out and disappear. What we've seen instead is that there's been a massive uptake, and we've seen all the numbers to do with our website, the number of people looking at our website, the number of people buying things. All these numbers have increased significantly, and the Raspberry Pi has been one of the main factors in that. The fact that RiskOS is included by default in the software for the Raspberry Pi has just been a massive bonus. And the fact that the people who are behind the Raspberry Pi are interested in RiskOS themselves. So there's some RiskOS enthusiasts within the Raspberry Pi Foundation, notably Eben Upton, who is the figurehead. He's always looking at little things he can do that will help RiskOS under the covers. So that's been a massive boost. But one of the things we have observed over these years, over the same period, was our donations, after an initial kind of peak when we set them up, I think it was in 2011, they've been on a gradual decline. So the amount of money to sustain our company has been decreasing, while the amount of stuff going on has been going through the roof. So our workload has been increasing and the money coming in decreasing. But we set up the recurring donations, and they've really made a big difference, because it only takes a small number of people to say, I'm going to give £5 or £10 a month, and it really improves the figures. So instead of worrying about coming to a show like today and thinking this is going to cost a few hundred pounds and it's going to wipe out that many donations, we've got enough ticking along to keep us going. It's been very useful. So those are the sorts of things we're doing, and the sorts of things that will be coming to RiskOS soon. I'm happy to hear from you guys if you've got any ideas for things we could do differently or extra things that you'd like to see us doing. Feel free. Or if you've got any questions, feel free to ask. Yes?
Can you explain how much more work is there to do before the USB implementation could be considered to complete, after the current round of changes being worked on has been made final?
Well, there's probably, complete is a difficult one. USB 3 support is one of the things that could be added. That's probably quite a significant amount of work. We're hoping that in RiskOS 5.22, so in the next couple of months, we'll have what we believe is to be stable USB on the Panda board, and Raspberry Pi, probably the Panda board will overtake the Raspberry Pi and how stable we believe it is in its to-do list of important items that we see remaining. USB, there's probably never a complete, and it's difficult to say what's complete, because there's things that you can always improve and optimize. Performance, things like Ethernet over USB, there's probably always going to be ways we can improve it. There's probably changes in the VSD stack or wherever that we can feed in bug fixes. So I think it's probably an ongoing continuous process, which doesn't really answer your question. It's just never is probably the succinct answer.
People update various portals.
Mm-hmm.
There's quite a good, albeit very detailed, description of the sort of innermost bits that they've done.
Yes.
What I find very difficult to do is to understand the user-facing effect. When something changes and makes a big change, it's worth talking about. USB on network, on the Pi recently,
yep.
Ether USB. I find it extremely difficult to distill that from all of the stuff there. Now, the information that's in the CES about what's changed is quite good, but it's very, very detailed.
Yes.
What is very difficult to do is to spot when all those little tweaks have suddenly actually also included a really big important tweak, even because it, in itself it would just be a few lines of code change. Is there any way you can think of to get, I mean, the authors will actually know, because they'll pat themselves on the back and go, oh, well, that solved that. But they don't tell anyone.
Yeah.
Well, the detail is still there. Don't be wrong. It's all there if you read every single word.
And understand it.
Even if you read every single word and understand it, you're still word blind. You wonder, well, was that good or not?
Yeah.
Is there any way of getting people to flag up some of these watersheds?
I think there's two routes to doing this. One that we are already doing, and one that we've attempted to do but not really completed. So the first way is all of the ongoing work that you see going into the source code, into the CVS, we have on our front page, there's a link to it that says recent changes in CVS, and you can see all these complicated change logs by the developers. And as you say, it's broadly techno babble, so to the user, it's very hard to interpret that, the average user. What we try to do is when we do a major milestone release like 5.2.2 or 5.2.0, we will do a release note, and we try very hard to distill what's probably hundreds or thousands of changes into a succinct summary of here's the user-facing impact of what this release gives you over the last major release. So this is a summary, and then here's some bullet points, slightly more technically, of what's changed, and then here's a whole load of change logs, all the detail.
I agree.
And most people don't need to read that far.
Because you do that well. You do that well.
What we don't do,
release, you do well.
What we don't do is, on an ongoing basis, we don't have if anyone does a milestone checking of something that's important, we don't distill that particularly well into an announcement which goes somewhere on the site.
Yes.
And we've tried, and you're probably aware, we've tried setting up a mailing list for announcements, and what it needs is some more technically literate people to be watching that stuff and then to go off and probe with the developer that made the change and say, what does this mean to the user? And then periodically you could author that, you know, this group of all volunteers who are helping do that job, they could author a draft press release to send to us, and then we'll just say, yep, that looks good. And then you'll have this trickle of translated change logs that have been translated into human, so they can actually be read and understood.
I think you need to get the software developers on board to shout a little bit more about when they've done something really good, because polishing up bits and pieces, bug fixing is great, but it has to go on, and it goes on all the time in huge detail. But when you actually suddenly say, we finally cracked that one, that now works properly.
Yeah.
There isn't any extra transmission that's what's missing, because if you know about it, you can track it down and say, oh yeah, it has happened, and that's where it happened, I'm right about it. But if you don't know about it, you've got this endless stream of stuff, and you can't tell from it whether it's important or not.
Yeah, so I mean, one way to help with that would be for us to say to all the developers who are active, say, if you believe you've done something that's kind of a milestone, then please send an email to this mailing list.
Yes, that's what you want.
And all the volunteers who are involved in drafting press releases can then latch onto it.
The software author can then say, no, you haven't understood. This is what we're doing. Which is exactly what you want to happen.
Yes. And the more that can be, we can delegate that out to a group of volunteers, the better. Hi.
What do you see as the most important thing for addressing a vulnerability in risk loss? And also, what sort of size pot would be needed in donations to address it?
The most important thing, I believe, is the file system improvements work. So we already have a bounty there, and it was. This is the second phase of about five phases of file system improvements. And ultimately, this is about supporting proper big hard drives. It's about supporting partitions properly, natively in RISC OS, and loads of other peripheral bits that RISC OS is so weak at the moment. Trying to make RISC OS coexist with other operating systems on the same media, on the same drive, is nearly impossible, because it just it can't understand the idea that it doesn't own everything. And it's just a problem. So the file system work is a big chunk of work, and the scale of the bounty at the moment is, well, I'm guessing, how is it, about £1,000 in there at the moment. And it was claimed by one person, but then they ultimately just, they didn't turn out to have the right skills, so they had to ditch it, and so we reopened the bounty. I think it probably needs to be hard-headed, 5 or 10 times that figure in the bounty pot before a developer with the right skills will come along and do it. Unless someone's feeling really generous and, you know, got all the right skills. But it is a hard problem to solve. You know, these are modules that are fundamental parts of the operating system that are written in ARM code. They're not written in C, so it's a pain to change them. One of the parts of our series of bounties is rewriting some of them in C. So going forward, they'll be a lot easier to maintain. Yes, I think we're quite a long way away. And that's the problem with a lot of these bounties. They're big, difficult tasks. And realistically, most developers think to themselves, if I'm going to make time for this, maybe I'll take several weeks of holiday, my annual leave, and do this stuff, because I need to get my head down and really focus on it. But that's going to cost me a lot of money to do that, and even at minimum wage, that it does quickly add up to quite a bit of money. And our bounty pots don't really reach those kind of figures. So maybe what we're looking for is just some wealthy benefactors to just come along and say, "Oh yeah, I've got £100,000 burning a hole in my pocket," and then suddenly all of these problems would potentially go away, because a lot of us developers would go, right, I'm taking 6 months off and I'm going to fix all these problems. So yeah, that would be very nice, but for the time being we just do our best to try and encourage people to donate and put money into the bounties. There's another question over here somewhere.
Just answer.
Did I? Okay.
Hi. What are we up against? These people who could take 6 months off, how much the earning? What
kind of levers would make people? It's it depends on the individual, because everyone's needs are different. Yeah, for example, I've got a family to support, and you know, mortgage and all of that stuff. Some people are more fortunate, less fortunate. They've not got family, they've not got dependents, and they've paid their mortgage off. So their outgoings are really low. Maybe they live in the middle of Cambridge and they haven't got a car, so their bills are nearly zero. So their cost of living basically is a lot lower. So they can afford to set their bar much lower. If I wanted to take 6 months off, we'd have to have quite large bounties to pay my bills. But yes, it's in tens of thousands of pounds. Is what it takes for someone, you know, for someone to take that amount of time and dedicate it to RISC OS. But you can be more pragmatic. You can say it's a smaller figure, and you'll just burn yourself out for a few months working all the weekends. So there are the other ways of tackling it. Realistically, I'd love it if this was a pot of money there big enough, and I could just quit. Say I want to go on an extended leave for 6 months, unpaid, and I can focus entirely on just doing all of these important things that RISC OS needs doing. That'd be great, but I'm not convinced our market is quite big enough yet, or the amount of money in the market is big enough yet to sustain that. Hi.
what, in your view, is the most important advance either you or Riskos have made since the last London trip?
Since the last... Riskos 5.20, I think, was since the last London show. So that was a milestone, because that was a big collecting together of all the work that had gone together for quite a long time before that, maybe 18 months. So there's loads of improvements and new features. I would say the development tools, I know it's not a very exciting user-facing thing, but the development tools, there's been a fundamental type of work done there, which is to get our heads around all of this FrameMaker, improving the books and the documents. And getting all of that in place opens up the door to potentially improving the programmer's reference manuals. And doing that is one of the fundamental steps towards helping getting new developers from outside of the Riskos community. Because if you take a new developer and say, here's our current PRMs, and oh, by the way, most of this is wrong, it's not particularly useful. And at the moment, we have to say, here's these, there's loads of stuff missing, loads of it's wrong and obsolete, and here's our website where people have tried to do some new stuff on the wiki, and it's incomplete, and it's mostly right, but there's massive holes in it. And oh yeah, there's a load of readmes and documents in CES, you can go and find those, it's just terrible. What really needs doing is the whole programmer's reference manual stack needs bringing up to date. But we believe that's probably 1.5 man years of work. So it's a vast amount of work. But we're now in a position where someone could do that, because we've got all the right bits in place and some of the knowledge and experience of updating these books. So that's quite useful. Plus fixing important bugs in the compiler is always good. One last question.
Does Riskos not take some credit for the port to IMX6, or is that not in the
itself? It's top secret. I don't even know.
Since the machine's being talked about, is
it? Yeah, the people involved in it is still top secret.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
So, yes, I couldn't possibly comment, but we know, yeah. I mean. Because of where we are, because of what we do, we're maintaining the closed source repository. We're maintaining the allocations database. So any time any work happens that's commercially sensitive, it still necessarily tends to come through us. So we're usually aware of quite a lot of things going on, even if we're not directly working on them. But in this particular instance, we may well have been working on it as well. I couldn't possibly say. Or we may not. Okay.
Yeah, approximately how many things are there going on now?
Commercial things. It's difficult to say. I'd say more than a handful, but more than five probably. Interesting things going on. Yeah, there's probably quite a few, yeah. I mean, this announcement today was certainly one of the headline things, especially if you're a RiskOS user and you want to replace your creaking old Ionics or RISC PC with something much newer and better, then clearly that's going to be interesting. But I wouldn't bet that's the only thing that's interesting that's on the horizon. There's all kinds of things. And there's tiny little things, like I'm playing with a little project in the background that's potentially a commercial thing, but it's tiny, it's just silly. But again, it's a commercial use of RiskOS that might happen.
What's the prospect of any of the present or future commercial things actually coming up with the tens of thousands of pounds you were talking about?
Yeah, good question. And how is that going to come to RiskOS Open? Even more difficult to answer, because the problem at the moment is RiskOS Open is this blob doing all the work. Castle Technology is the blob that owns the IPR and doesn't do the work. And so all the money goes over here for licensing. So if anyone licenses RiskOS, they pay the money to Castle. There are several ways this could be addressed. One is Castle might start paying a cut of their license fee to RiskOS Open in recognition of the fact that they are the ones making it all possible. Another way is that commercial developments might need to subcontract some of the development work. So if someone has an idea for a project and it involves RiskOS, they're going to need to go to RiskOS expert programmers, and we know a couple. So like the INX6 might have done, or might not have done. So there are some ways that money can come in and land in the pot. If you have ideas for other ones, let me know. You're very interested to know. Another way is a rich benefactor could just buy RiskOS wholesale off Castle, maybe. And then who knows what might happen there. Yeah. What would be nice, ultimately, is to see RiskOS truly open sourced. And then a lot of the barriers that still remain will go away. We've had recent heated discussions on the forums about that very subject. And it would be nice to know that it doesn't have the same barriers to developers who are used to being able to work on software and know that that contribution is theirs, they own it. They may not get royalties from it, but they own it at least. Whereas at the moment, if you develop anything that's Castle licensed, you're basically saying, here you go Castle, that's all yours now. And some people, that's not acceptable. So there's probably a lot of developers out there that could get involved that aren't doing it. Are we all right for time, sorry?
There's nobody else after you.
Right. I'll keep hitting you with questions.
When Castle bought RiskOS IPR, they cost quite a large amount of money for it.
I would imagine so, yeah.
Several degrees of optimism about how much money it was going to make them.
Yes.
Have they got to a stage where they feel that it's now a sideline, or is it still a real headline thing that they're hoping to bring real money in due course?
I suspect it's an emotional thing as much as anything. It's difficult to wave goodbye when you've made a large investment, even after however many years it's been, 14, 13 years. And to see this trajectory of usage and exposure, I'm sure they can't help thinking maybe there's some big money around the corner. There are people starting to buy licenses for RiskOS to use it in commercial projects.
Yes.
But whether it's realistic to expect they're ever going to see that much money back in from the licensing, it's hard to say.
So they're not looking for a buyer?
Well, I imagine if someone came along and offered them some amount that was similar to what they paid, they'd be quite happy to bite their hand off.
But
yeah, we know that. It's yes, but it's an emotional thing, isn't it? They may strategically feel that maybe there's something around the corner that will suddenly be worth loads. But to be honest, you only have to look at stories like BlackBerry to know that software is just not worth anything. When you look at all their revenues, all their billions of dollars, and it was, you know, their products and their consultancy and their software was this little slither down the bottom. It's effectively worthless. You need to give away software for free. And you need to somehow get money to pay for development by consultancy or services or products, some physical products.
Okay.
So I'm very skeptical that simply owning RiskOS and wanting to rake in lots of royalties is ever going to make anyone a significant amount of money, or whether that's more of just another barrier that's stopping it being adopted commercially. It's a tricky one. But it's up to them, really. No one else can influence them. One last question, go on.
These secret new things which you're going to be able to buy,
yep.
Should we wait until the Wakefield show, or do we have to come to Bristol?
Yes.
Depends when you believe Christmas is.
When it comes, yeah.
Christmas.
Well, in the IMX talk,
they're
hoping for Christmas, aren't they?
But they're quite keen on getting them at the South West Show, aren't they?
Yeah. I think they'd be disappointed not to get them there.
IMX is just
Thank you all.